Good afternoon. Thanks very much for coming to the class today. Today's class is dedicated to Diane and Selby Sullivan, and I think they are here, right? I believe. I'm not sure. Anyway, but give them some love. That's good. Before we go a step further, I want to encourage all of you to make plans to come to see our opera, which is going to be the weekend after this one. It's The Bartered Bride. It's going to be down at the Granada Theater. It's a wonderfully lyric, human piece of theater. And it's sort of a comedy and sort of a drama, and in that way, it's entirely human. And you're going to have a great time. It's beautiful melodies, beautiful orchestration. It is very difficult for the orchestra to play. It's a very big challenge for the orchestra. And we have a wonderful cast. So please make your plans to be there. We're going to have a good time. Today's class is a little bit different from a class, any kind of class that I've given here before, in the sense that I ask all of these people to learn the music that they're going to sing today within the last week. And I had a meeting with them, and I made a deal with them. I asked them to please try learning this music somewhat along the guidelines that I would like them to do. And I believe they have. And so today we're going to hear recently learned songs in English, as well as one Italian aria at the end, which is a much bigger project, believe me. But let's get right to some music and have Brittany and Milena come up and do the introduction. Before the class, Brittany said to me, she said, you know, I'm very nervous today because I've never done the beginning bar correctly in the week that she's had to work on. And I said to her, I implored her to take a very Californian outlook about that, which is that if you have never done it well, then you can always do it well. And today's the first day that she's going to do it well, and you were perfect. Excellent. See, part of what we're going to talk about today is how your brain and your concentration can work amazing things. Brittany, talk to us about the text. Can you just, in your words, describe the picture that we're seeing right now? The picture, I should say, the picture that you are seeing right now.
Yes. A grassy bank with a nice stream, and we see it's still morning, so the sun is bright, there's not very many clouds, There's still little dew particles on the grass that haven't been disturbed yet by any feet or any, you know, creatures. The birds are getting ready to take flight. Even the snails, which are hanging out on the branches of the, you know, of the tree and of the flowers, is getting ready to go. Everything's where it's supposed to be, including God, who's at home in his heaven. All is right.
Great, great. Now, Milena, would you mind just say the text in that case? Yeah, just stand right up and do it. Here we go.
The years of the spring, the days of the morn, mornings at 7, the hillside's dew curled, the larks on the wind, the snails on the thorn, God's in his heaven, all is right with the world.
Right. See, my idea about these texts is this. None of these texts of the English songs that we're going to do today is complicated. They're fairly simple. And I know that sometimes texts can get much more complicated than this. And the complications then grow when you work in a foreign language. But to demonstrate this principle, I intentionally picked 5 fairly easy texts to deal with. And the premise is this. Now there's going to be a rant. Okay? I grew up in a rural atmosphere in the American South. And while we had television, we did not have a record player. We didn't have anything. We had a radio in the house, but that was just for emergencies because it was one of those newfangled transistor radios. And so I never heard music growing up unless I was doing the music. That's what it was. And I was always encouraged by my teachers, both in public school and my private music teachers, to use my imagination and to get a picture of what I'm playing about, of what I'm singing about, because I did sing, you know, as a child. And the idea of making your picture in your brain, in your imagination, is an incredibly strong, motivating thing to do. And see, that's what I asked Brittany to do. And Brittany, when I met with Brittany about this song, because see, I've met all these people about the songs today. I'm not hearing them for the first time. When I met her, she had the poem memorized in 10 minutes. Because she got the picture of the poem, and then it was just simply a matter of talking about demonstrating, describing the picture. She wasn't thinking about which word comes next. She just said, the years at the spring, right? And you have this picture of springtime, yeah? Here we go. So I thought about one thing in preparation for this class. How many of you have seen Psycho? You know, generous number. So you are familiar with the shower scene. In the shower scene, you hear... There's no special effects in the movie, you know. There's not any special effects. And the music is all acoustic music. It's just simply violins going, dee, 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 just repeated down bows, okay? A single tone. That's all you do. There is no contact at all. You see the knife. You see the woman in the shower. You see the water running. You see the shower curtain. You see a little bit of blood coming into the water. But if you know the scene, you never, ever see anything that is at all violent. There is nothing violent in the scene. Go look at it. It is an incredibly normal bunch of shots because Hitchcock knew that if he used the right tools to stimulate the audience's imagination, that what you think is happening is much more powerful than anything he could put on the screen. And that's why people are terrorized by that scene, is because they are in your imagination, you go crazy, thinking about what am I not seeing, okay? And having the ability to have an imagination is an amazing thing. That's why I always tell you, put down your iPads, put down your computers, put down all those things that cause you to just look at things. And start thinking about what you're doing. and imagining what you're doing. It is the greatest thing to do. So, let's do it. Do you mind to sing the song one more time? What's going on at the end?
At the end?
Yep.
Everything.
Y'all got a little crossed.
Oh,
no, I'm just talking about music.
Yes.
What?
I jumped.
Okay. How are you remembering that passage? God's in his heaven, all's right. How are you doing that? How many beats long is right?
Seven.
If you've been in a casino, seven is a right number. Can you remember it that way? See, I don't care how you remember it. It doesn't make any difference. If seven is lucky for you, if seven is right, then you go, right. Wait, and it's seven beats. So when we get there, let's think about the casino. See what happens. Can we do one time? Can we do the first God's in his heaven? Yep.
God's in his heaven.
I really don't care what the connection that you make is, but you sang that note with conviction all the way to the end of the word. And that's what's important. You have to remember, the audience is going to carry away whatever the audience carries away. What you bring to it, right, to get them to carry something away, that's your toolbox. That's what you want to do. And if it means thinking about rolling seven in a casino, fine, as far as I'm concerned. Okay?
Okay.
You mind to do one more time the beginning of the song, just for practice?
Don't mind.
I believe that every song we're going to do today of the songs is in this way. If you declaim this text like you would do it in a straight theater, sustaining your voice, right? Do that one time. Brittany, like you are in the Granada Theater, like you in the Metropolitan, and you have 3,750 people there that you have to talk to. Remember, I don't know if you are aware of this. You know, William McKinley was the president of the United States that was assassinated in 1901. The day before he was killed, he gave a speech in Buffalo, New York at the Pan American Exposition to unamplified to 30,000 people. That is equivalent to standing on the 50-yard line at Giant Stadium in the Meadowlands and talking to half the stadium without a microphone. You can do that. All you have to do is sustain your voice. And you start to talk like this, and you feel your voice going there, out all the way out to Mary Collier, back there in the back. And you feel what it feels like to do that. So. Sustain your voice and say the text one time. We're just going to do like the first four lines, and then we'll talk about it for a minute.
The years at the spring, and days at the morn, mornings at seven, the hillsides dew pearled.
Now, the tempo of the song is basically that speed. So do it one time. Say the lines one more time, and then when she's finished, give her the downbeat, and let's see what happens.
The years at the spring, the days at the morn, mornings at seven, the hillsides do pearl.
Ready and run.
Years at the spring.
Out there. Yeah, that's it. Right. You see, they don't call it a recital just randomly. You are literally reciting the text. Did you have the feeling when you were singing now that you were actually saying the words to the public?
Yes, and it's a lot easier when you put it in that.
Why is it easier, Brittany? That's a great observation. Why is it easier?
Because it's just another way of telling the story. It's not worrying about the mechanism or the singing or whether you're going to come in at the right time. It's just another way to tell the story.
And did you notice how your brain, when you were engaged that way, your support was working all the way to the end of the phrase? You were pronouncing all the words all the way to the end of the word? Everything came out. That's all about your brain. You can stand there and dryly think about keeping my support, and I have to support to the end of the phrase. Or, as Fred did the other day in his class, you can engage your brain and sing to the end of the phrase. Just determinedly do it, okay? You got a question?
I don't.
Let's go on. Thank you very much. Thank you. Miss Sletadal, who is scheduled to play the piano this afternoon for Courtney, was up all night with food poisoning. And believe me, I remember I didn't used to cancel ever, never. Never. I was totally not a canceller. And then one time I couldn't sit up. And I said, I'm not playing the piano today. And I don't. So. She's not here today because she's not feeling well, and so Courtney and I, unrehearsed, are going to do this little song. Let's see what it is. Keep your fingers crossed. I can't cross mine, so. Let's see what we do. Describe to us a little bit of what we talked about the scene.
Yes.
For example, yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
I'm picturing myself standing on a balcony, and I'm looking off the balcony into the garden below, and I'm seeing Pierrot standing there and making up this tune and playing for me.
Great. What if, for example, you see the words? If you say, Pierrot stands in the garden beneath a waning moon. Now, when we first met about this, Courtney wanted to say under a waning moon. Under is the same syllables as beneath, right? It's not the same accent, but it means the same thing, ostensibly. But I encouraged her to think about the fact that, and I'm just telling you from my brain, because everyone reads words differently. The word beneath to me means beneath. It doesn't mean under. Do you understand the difference of that? I mean, that's just the way my brain works. Other people's works differently, right? And to remember that he is beneath a waning moon means that I'm here, he's there, the moon is there. The moon is not over there. It's not there. So that you develop the I developed the picture, and I think, Courtney, you sort of got onto that idea, that you develop the picture of what it means according to how your words work about what you're saying, that he's standing beneath a moon. So, ooh. And then suddenly the picture is much more vivid. That's one of the things that you have to learn about song singing. Song singing has to be vivid in the word communication. Way more in a certain way than opera. In opera, you have like 4 hours sometimes to get your point across. If you sing a song recital, you have 20 little lives, 20 little pictures, 20 little emotions, 20 little scenes that you are doing. And you have to get to the point quickly and do it. Yeah? So, what happens in the second verse?
In the second verse, he begins playing. Piero begins playing the tune that he's made up.
Uh-huh. And?
And
you say Piero plays in the garden,
yes,
right?
Yes, he plays in the garden.
Okay. Keep going.
And I'm saying that Piero thinks that he's serenading me and that he's playing for me. But I know that our love is a little unrequited and that he's already forgotten about me.
If you were on the balcony at the beginning, mm-hmm. where are you now?
I still think I'm on the balcony.
What about being with the cherry tree?
Under the cherry tree, I pictured that was our time together, was under the cherry tree. Not that I'm there currently.
Okay. Again, if that picture works, that's fine. Because, in other words, so there's now we know, what else do we find out? We find out there's a cherry tree in the garden. You see, each one of these verses, it works like a short story. Each one of these verses gives you more information to fill in the picture, fill in the emotion, fill in the scene, fill in the story. Okay? And each one of those, so now we know that. And then the third verse?
And in the third verse, Piero is still playing, and I'm saying that even the roses in the garden know that Piero loves his music. But the sad thing is that I love Piero.
Great, okay, and again, how did you think about the roses? Tell them about that meeting that we had. I'm working in the chapel down at Westmont College this summer. If you know that little prayer chapel in the middle of the campus, you know that there's a rose garden out in front of it, right? And so we're standing there it wasn't planned this way, but you remarked.
That, I don't know, it was just the door was open, so I could see the roses out there, and I just pictured Piero out there with the roses. And they were listening to what he was saying.
Yeah, talk to us about what did we say about the roses? You know, about how I made the observation that, you know, roses don't talk to us, as far as we know. However, they probably hear a great deal. Especially if you have people getting married in that chapel. And they're walking down there, right? So, and the roses know. If you, again, whatever gets your brain to do that, okay? Are you good?
Yep.
Listen, I just wanted you to sing the song today and talk to us. Thanks so much, very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. So, Mr. Dwan and Mr. Sun, please. Let's see what we're doing. Give him some love here. How are you? You want to talk before you sing this time?
Either one. What would you like?
Well, let's see. I will tell you that because of the schedule of staging with the opera, I was not able to talk with Andy so much before he learned this, right? So, but we had a meeting subsequently about that. You want to tell us a little bit about that?
So my picture for the story. In this, I'm picturing that I'm sitting on a hammock. I'm lying down on a hammock with my little baby girl. I'm picturing around 4 years old, little cute head of blonde hair, as I'm rocking her to sleep, and I can't even move because I would disturb her. And I'm just seeing the sunset and the sounds of nature come out. And
so, Ian, for example, if he's seeing the sunset, which way is he looking?
West.
Yeah. I mean, see, they're little things. You aced it, baby. That's right. But see, all those little clues make the piece vivid, right? I pointed out something to him because initially Andy and Andrew, both of them, I didn't realize, oh, I have the Andrew. This is like the Andrews brothers. Oh, my God. That was entirely unintentional, I'm sorry. Both of them, when they came in talking about memorizing the poem, said, if you look at the text, they said, or the mountains towards the west. And I said, no, that's not what it says. They looked at it again. Both of them did the same thing and looked at it, and they said, yeah, or the mountains towards the west. And I said, that's not what it says. Look at it again. And they went, oh, mountain. I said, so, I'm telling you how I know the text. I know the text because Ives wrote these words. He lived in Connecticut. If you know Connecticut, you know that while they have very beautiful, I hope someone's watching in the live stream from Connecticut. Hello out there. They have beautiful mountains, but their mountains are really sort of nice hills. And very beautiful hills, okay? And they're not like ranges of hills. They're like a hill. And then there's a hill. A friend of mine lives in Bloomfield, Connecticut. He drives over Avon Mountain to get to Avon. That's the only hill around. And you have to drive over it to get to Avon. And so if you know that about Connecticut, then you cannot say mountains because there aren't mountains. You just say, there's a mountain there. And you say, or the mountain. That's it. And both of them got onto that. So they got it. Let's hear the song, see what you do. We might talk about the song a little bit. So let's talk about the text a little bit, Andrew, okay? You like Andy, right?
Andy,
okay, that'll be great. Okay. In this text, in the way the text plays in your head, are things coming to you? Are you seeing things? Is there movement? What's going on?
I think as my child is drifting off asleep, and it's been a long day with all of them running around, and it's only now that it's in complete silence that I'm actually hearing the sounds that have been there for a little while.
Okay, so at the beginning, you're just absorbing things.
Yeah.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Okay, now. And then you say in the words at a certain point that something comes to you. Mm-hmm. Right. Now, does anything ever go from you in the text?
I think from me to my child.
Your wishes for them to sleep well.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. Now, so, think about the fact that you are getting things, you're not doing that. Now, in the middle of the song, when you said faintly comes the sound, you got substantially louder. I'm not convinced that that's a good way of depicting the text. Let's do one more time. You understand? You get what I mean, yeah? Okay? Yeah? Andrew, that's played very beautifully. Can I ask you one of the things? Now, one of the things to think about, see, when you learn the text, I don't know if I said this when I gave a class here before. You know, this is Mr. Ives' text, Mr. Ives' music. Now, what we have heard now is Mr. Dwan's version of Mr. Ives' version of his text, right? And they are going to carry out, for example, when Mr. Churchwell goes out of here, he will carry out Mr. Churchwell's version of Mr. Dwan's version of Mr. Ives' version of an evening. That's why everything, every point in that transaction has to be vivid. That's what we're talking about. So, I don't know if there's a reason to get big there. So let's see what happens. And Andrew, what do you think? What do you think, Andrew? What's the difference between playing C sharp major and C sharp minor? Get entirely seventh grade about it. What did they tell you?
Half step.
Yeah, but I'm talking about what they don't give a crap about half steps. They don't know what a half step. Do y'all know what a half step is? Some of you may. That's right. Corbin knows what a half step is. Good. Play C-sharp major. Just play like a C-sharp major chord like this. Like, you know, this space. And like C-sharp, G-sharp. Play a chord just like that. Take out the fifth in the right hand. Just play an open sixth in the right hand. Now play that. Play it one more time. Just listen. Now play that same spacing, the same thing. Play a C-sharp minor chord. So, let's just pick anybody out of the studio audience. How are you?
Can you say
your name? Nope. Right here. Yes. How are you? What's the difference for you between those two chords? What, you want to hear them again?
Yes.
Listen to them again. It's lower, but I mean emotionally, what does it mean to you?
Well, the first one is sort of like this, and the second one is a little bit more peaceful.
A little more peaceful? Good. Now you know what they're getting? Okay, now play the beginning of the song again. See, you have to, when you are playing, again, I'm totally with Fred about the idea that, you know, you can feel all you want, but what your job on the stage is to do is to get them to feel it, right? And it helps first to know how they react, like, for example, like our friend did, okay? So, here we go. Notice when it comes to C-sharp minor. You'll all hear it. You have said west and rest. React to the music. Do something special when you say west as opposed to rest. One more time. Hear the music. Restful, right? The lady said that she felt like this when she heard C sharp minor. So do that. Do that. See what happens. Don't give it out like that. Exactly. Faintly one second. Yep. Now, when you sing, this is just something to know about lullabies. When you sing lullabies, this is just sort of pro forma. This is how it works. The beginning of the lullaby is almost always for the child, because you're trying to get the kid to go to sleep. And then, that's what the job of the song is to get the kid to go to sleep. In most lullabies, as the lullaby progresses, the words turn personal for the singer. And the singer expresses something. Now, you're going to hear him say twice, "Sleep thee well till morning light." So, Ricky, what do you think the difference is? If he's going to say one time to the kid, wishing the kid to sleep well until morning, and then he's going to say it again, and he says those words for himself, what do you think that means? Can you imagine a meaning for that?
A meaning for saying it to himself?
Yes.
Yeah, it's just like, it's more of a peaceful thing for him. I think knowing that his child is going to sleep well.
So is he like saying, please God, that my kid will sleep well tonight? Not because he doesn't want to be awakened to change a diaper or something like that. I'm not talking about, but it's like, it's your most fervent hope that your child will sleep peacefully in his bed. And you say it to yourself so that when you repeat it after the little interlude here, it becomes a whole different piece of work. Yeah. So where can we start? Can we start from, "Tis the beauty of," that was, I love the way you said faintly. That was great. Was just a perfect word painting. Let's do one, yeah, so.
"Tis the beauty of the night, sleep thee well till morning light."
Great. Beautiful. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you very much. Thank you. That's beautiful. Beautiful. Beautiful.
Hold on one second. Just so you know, one thing to think about also for when they're going to do the play out, you know that it's a da 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 da, and then it's beautiful, C sharp major, right? And then the last thing that Ives has you play is this. And see, again, you have to be a little bit seventh grade about it. Open fifths in European music, an open fifth connotes an unknown. You don't know, is it this or is it this? It's just this. So it's the open fifth in a certain way is fraught with danger and uncertainty. You don't know what it is. And so the play out of the song, as opposed to being restful in a certain way, leaves you like, please God, please make it a good night for him. I don't know what could happen tonight, but I want my son to, or my daughter to sleep that way. Yeah? So just to think about that when you listen to the play out and when you're playing it, okay? Thank you so much. Great, 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 great. Now we have a whole different kind of Ives song now, again on his words. So let's see what you do, gentlemen. This song is a particular favorite of mine because I grew up from the seventh grade playing in the high school band. And yes, I was in the high school band in the seventh grade because I went to a high school that the entire enrollment, it was a public school in the country, the entire enrollment in the high school was less than 300 people. And we had, believe it or not, 60 people in our marching band. 60 of 300 were in the marching band. And we had another 60 who were in the choir. When you think about the fact that two-fifths of the student body in a public school actively engaged every day in music, that's what we need today. And you will hear when Nathaniel plays the little interlude before the band gets really near. The band, how many of you have been in a parade and had a band play blowing their brains out because, you know, they want to play bigger and better than the band from down the road. So every band tries to play as loud as they can, right, and march in step and everything. So they get to you, and it just becomes an unbelievable amount of racket in front of you. The trombone players, and the trumpet players. Well, you'll hear Nathaniel play the proverbial, like, 10th or 11th chair trumpet player who's playing like third trumpet, who comes in early. And you'll hear a little thing, a little sort of snotty nose, and then the whole band goes, da 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 da, like that. So have a good time, boys. Let's see what you do. Excellent. Can we talk about how you remembered can you just tell them how we talked about remembering horses? Horses are prancing. Tell us about that. What's the line? Line is?
Horses are prancing, knights advancing, helmets gleaming, pennants streaming.
So, how did we talk about that?
So, hard to believe at someone at my height, but this song is someone who's supposed to be like 5 years old, and so he's seeing the world from below where I would be on my knees. But so we have the picture being that he's, you know, seeing at first as the marching band is coming towards, and he sees like, and the circus, he sees like
from the bottom coming up that there's like the horses, so you see the hooves of the horses, and then you look up and you see the knight on the horse, and then just above that you see his like gleaming helmet in the sun, and then above that you see his, the pennant or his banner streaming from the top. So it's like this kind of wave motion that you get from a broad look up.
You see? And once we talked that out, it was memorized. It's really rather easy. Once you get the picture, just describe the picture like that, right? Okay, so what about the lady in pink? Nathaniel, talk to us about that.
Well, she's all in pink, so she's got pink shoes and socks and skirt, petticoats, and a blouse. And
is she like girly?
She's such a girl.
She's really girly, okay? And you're, I encouraged the gentleman to think about this song like, because, you know, it's hard to think that a five-year-old would sing this, but an adult can remember how he felt when he was five and sing that. So, as a five-year-old, what about you and the lady in pink?
Well, from my tiny little town in this song, I'd never seen anybody so girly as that in my whole life.
Good. And, yeah, and? When she waved at you, what'd you do?
Why, how so special?
And now, where is she?
Well, she hasn't died, but she doesn't notice me either.
This time, exactly. So what about, you see in your, if you look in the words, you see very interesting little sort of apocryphative sentences that just say, can, ? That, exclamation point, rot, exclamation point. Talk to us.
Well, it's three sentences, because there's three punctuation marks, and it's, like in a kid's brain, how thoughts sort of crowd each other. Can she be here still, or is she not there? That might be her, that's not it. And rot, which is like almost a swear word, I guess.
Well, for him it is. Yeah. So it's like, can that be the woman in pink? That is the woman in pink! She's looking the other way this year. Right? Good, okay. All right, now, okay, let's talk about just one thing, about in the first thing, your F sharp. I promise, if you thread the needle going up there just a little bit better, you know what I mean by that?
Yeah.
The F sharp's gonna pop out of your mouth, and that's what it has to do.
Sure.
Okay? Let's do one time from the beginning, see what happens, yeah? Oh, eight, and just, I know you're not, you know, everyone talks about, you know what glotting is? Some people are going yes, and some of you are going like, what? Glotting is when you say something like, you can't say, oh ain't. You say in English, you go, oh ain't. And that little like that is a glot. They are fastidiously asked not to glot in Italian. You never glot in Italian. In English, you glot all the time. In German, you glot all the time. You cannot say, das ist ein wunderbares Ding. You can't say das ist ein, sistein. No, das ist ein. You hear that little thing in the beginning of each word? Do that when you get to ain't.
Sure.
Oh, ain't it a great, no, and see what happens. You're gonna be amazed at what your body will do. One more time, here we go. Double. Do me one favor.
Yeah.
Sing the softer one and find someone in the audience and sing. I don't care if you know them or not. Find someone in the audience and just sing it to them. Don't look around.
Okay. Sure.
Again, some of y'all that have been in to see me have had this speech. You know, if you focus your eyes, your body works as an organism. If you focus your eyes, it is amazing what your body will do. It just gets, if I'm talking to Ben, I'm talking to Ben just like this, and I'm not talking to Ian, I'm talking to Ben like that, and I'm talking that way to him. I don't care if you're waving at me, Ian. It doesn't make any difference. I'm talking to Ben. You see? Focus your eyes and see what it does. You're going to be, it's much more electrifying if you'll do that.
Okay.
Y'all understand? If you see someone do this, if they're going, Because I tell people, you know, so you know where I'm coming from. I don't care what your skin color is, doesn't make any difference. You can be green, purple polka dots, I don't care what your skin color is. You have three things that are white on your face, that are the whites of your eyes and your teeth. And that's where, in effect, because they're the brightest things on your face, they're the things that send the most light back into the auditorium. It's like having a mirror, okay? If your eyes are wandering, everyone's wandering. If you are looking like this and talking that way, then you are looking that way. See, you see the light in my eyes. You can't see it very well with my glasses, but you see what I mean? It's just like that. It's not sort of like this talking to you, right? You see what that looks like? Here we go. Let's do it one more time. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. Let's do the second one. Can he play you from ain't to ground? That was a really good ain't. One more time. He's going to play you from ain't to ground, and you're going to do the second verse. Okay. Step out. Step out from the piano. One step. Find somebody and sing the next verse to him. See the difference of that? When his eyes are focused, that's all it takes. Your body just gets in line.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Are you good? Yeah. Now let's talk about, can we do the roll off? Do you know, how many of you were in high school band? Oh, okay. You know what a roll off is? Did you were in a marching band?
Yes.
You know what the roll off is before you play a march? You're walking along with a cadence,
yes.
And then you get dum-dum, yes. Dum-dum. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da Okay? You gotta play yum-tum, 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 dum-tum, like that. Just that way. Yum. No, it's a yum, it's a yum-bum, yum-bum, bum-bum, bum-bum. Play strongly in rhythm. That, believe me, I was the bass drummer in high school. It's the most fun. It's just a gas to be the bass drummer. You got to feel that the rhythm is just, you are marching ahead. It's not, you don't just sort of like... It's not. Here we go. Yum, 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 yum. No, wait a minute. The next to last note is early. It's yum, dum, bum, bum. Okay. Sing it one time. From the beginning.
Da, 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 da.
No, this is not the downbeat.
Oh, gotcha.
That's what I'm saying. It's okay. Yum, bum, bum, bum.
Yes.
Yum, 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 bum, bum. That's the role. Thank you very much. And then you hear the sound of the band. Nathaniel, I would love for you to play the first go of the march really very much like it's from a distance.
Okay.
Like that. No crescendo, it just sits there, okay? One more time from the roll off.
Sure.
Yeah. Focus your eyes.
Last year she waved to me, I think. Can she have died? Can that? Hurt. But she's passing what she sees me.
Now, big. I truly hope that all of you in this room right now read the next text. I have intentionally put it on this class because of what it says. And if you can, you need to read it and go home and think about it. with the way the world is today. So here we go. Let's see what you do. You know, for me, I will tell you one of the, I don't do a whole lot of contemporary music because I've sort of made my career playing, I know this sounds may sound tacky, but I've made my living playing commercially viable music in large spaces. And that is frequently not contemporary music. So I don't know a whole lot of composers. This composer I know. And she is one of my favorite composers of songs because she has not had an easy life in her in raising her children and her growing up. She's a few years younger than I am. She lives in Washington, D.C. And her, I love the setting of this. I sort of wanted to put this song on for the words today, but also so that all of you would hear some of her music because she has written some really amazing songs. And you need to look at them because they're great singing. She has a wonderful way of composing for a singing voice. You know what I mean? Do you find it singable?
Yeah, it just sings itself.
Exactly, exactly. So let's talk about one thing at the beginning. Before we talk about with you, Nicole. Ji-young, when you're playing at the end, would you mind to play from where she starts humming? You're not gonna hum. Yep. And just be aware of the fact. Let me go there for 1 second. If you have this music, what's going to happen? You could play this. You could. Light, right? No. You could do all things. You know, all kinds of stuff. And, But thank God, this is just nice and simple. And when you make whatever, Ji Young, I want you to think about the fact you are making up here. And see, Hojo, I've been talking to you about this a lot this summer. You know, you are making a picture of sound with the piano. And when you find, when you come here, wherever you are there, I think I said this in the earlier class about getting inside the sound. Did I say that? See, wherever you are, it doesn't make any difference where you are. And get inside it. Just do that to it, like you're having that little robin in your hand, you know? Don't let it go. Do one more time. And what if I told you, for example, in making your sound picture, that when you cross your hands at the end, that was like the star in the sky or something, that everything I've made is here, and now I just make a little thing there. Do one more time. Again, get inside the sound, GM. That's really not much of a star. Do one more time. It has to have enough sound to be heard, but you still, it just wants to twinkle. One more time. And again, just trust your weight when you get there. Just do that. Just do that. Okay? See how it is? You see, look at her smiling. That's a good thing. Yeah. Okay, can we go back in the song now? Can we talk about this just a little bit, Nicole? See, Nicole, I've listened to you sing that a little bit this summer. So I'm glad to have you on the class now, having heard you sing in some classes and heard you sing in like the cover run through the other night, stuff like that. I think, personally, that you have a very creamy, rich voice that you don't always let out.
Okay.
Now, think about the words of this song, because when you get into the part about the robin, your voice sounds different. But I want your voice to have that kind of creamy quality when you're talking at the beginning.
Okay.
Again, you don't have to like cry about someone whose heart was breaking and you couldn't help them and like this. You don't have to, I find the words of this song to be, they're like golden words from Miss Dickinson. And they want the warmest sound you can muster. However you do that, I don't care.
Okay.
Just sing. If it helps you to think about the meaning of the words, fine. If it helps you to think about pancake batter, then think about pancake batter. I don't care, but just do me something that's nice and golden.
Okay.
Here we go. That's beautiful. That's a beautiful sound. Now take that sound and be vivid with the words.
Okay.
Again, I don't know. Have I made this example to y'all? You know, if I say like, I know exactly what I just said. But I would wager that unless you knew the words, you didn't know, have any idea what was going on. You got to say the words and be vivid.
Okay.
With your beautiful voice. Here we go.
If I can stop my heart from breaking, I shall not leave.
See, I gotta hear the word, Nicole. I have to hear nest.
Okay.
Nest again. That much energy. Are you like asked never to sing shadow vowels in English?
No.
Where's Allie? See, if you heard this woman sing, how many of you were in the picnic concert the other night when Allie Smithers and Madeline and the clarinetist Rebecca played the Aurorum songs, the Ariel songs? You got it. Because you went for it, and the effect in the auditorium was electric. And there were a lot of shadow vowels that night. And did anyone care? No. Just, you got to do them.
Okay.
Okay? Mm-hmm. I mean, okay. That's enough said. I won't rant about that. Okay, here we go. One more time.
If I can stop one heart from breaking, I shall not live in vain. If I can ease one life aching, or cool one pain,
nest.
Okay.
St.
Okay.
Do one time. Or help on. Yeah.
Or help on fading moment unto his nest again. We shall not live in vain.
Sing the sounds. Say the words to yourself while she plays. Say the words to you, or sing the words to yourself. See it on your face. Show them your face. Just. Gotta sing, do it. Hold on one second, hold on one second. Did you hear the difference in her voice just now when she came in the middle of that phrase? Why do you think that was, Ricky? Her head and her heart were engaged in the activity. And then it just took flight. That's what you got to do. Wherever you are. We're not sitting there playing for our health. You know, we are actually there helping you with your stuff. And you are helping us with our stuff. So stay on the track that way, right? Mm-hmm. Can we do one more time that little interlude? Show the audience, don't mouth the words, show it in your face what you are doing. Can we start from the interlude?
Oh,
I'll go straight out on the twig. Now, I'm not going to be on a branch or a limb. I'm going to go on the twig and say, in my estimation, that was the best note I heard you sing all summer, that top note. That was wonderfully round and supported and had full of meaning and everything like that. Mm-hmm. Again, I don't know what you were doing to do it. I don't care. It was fabulous. That was great. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you very much, both of you. Thanks a lot. Thank you, Gia. Thank you. So now, while they set the stage for the next one, I'll tell you the story of this particular piece today. And how many of you saw Mr. O'Coin's opera down at the Libero Theater that night? Well, some of you were in it, I know, so okay. In that performance, the young man, Alan Chan, who sang, I think your character was named Jake, right? In that performance, about 5 minutes from the end, completely, 100%, ruptured one of his Achilles tendons. And he kept singing to the end. If you were there, nobody knew the difference. I mean, he just stood there and courageously sang. He did. And he's had surgery on his leg now while he's been here in San Francisco at the Cottage Hospital and is recovering nicely. He was, however, he made the decision not to sing his role that was assigned him in the opera, and in place of his part singing Vashek, we have Matthew Reardon singing it. Matthew's here, yes, okay. And when you made that decision, the day you made that decision, Alan has a repertory list that is about 5 miles long. I mean, it goes on for pages and pages. This is a prodigious music learner, and I thought, I know a piece that he doesn't have on his list. And I showed it to him, and he agreed to learn it for today. So come on up, guys. Hoje, come ahead. Back a little bit. You good?
Okay.
Are you good?
Yeah.
You good? Okay. So I'm going to tell you what's going on in this opera. This is a little known opera of Donizetti, Lion nell'imbarazzo. It actually was Donizetti's first success as a composer. He became widely known for this piece. It is a fairly short comedy of about 2 hours and 20 minutes in two acts with an intermission. It only lasts 2 hours and 20 minutes. It concerns several people. There is father in the house, who I'll tell you about. There are his two sons. There is the lyric soprano who lives next door. There is the mezzo soprano who is the maid in the house. There is the head of the servants who is a bass. And there is a tutor who lives in the house who homeschools the boys, the two sons. Now, this is one of the sons, the lyric tenor. The Mr. Giulio, the father, for some reason that is not explained in the libretto, even though he has two boys, he is morally opposed to women. He is determined that they are the end of the world, the root of all evil, and he is going to keep his boys from women at any cost. And this is the state in which we find the tenor. Because what the father doesn't know is that the lyric tenor is already married to the soprano who lives next door, and they have a child, and that the character tenor, the other son, is having an affair with the mezzo soprano in the house. The comedy in the piece comes from the fact that the tutor, who is the homeschool teacher for the two boys, knows every secret of every character. And yet no other character knows any secrets about the other characters. And so that he is in the center of the comedy and the drama. I have to tell you, because I want you to know what this opera, in the end of the opera, toward the end of the opera, the soprano becomes tired. He goes out every night, he climbs out of his window and goes across the alley, climbs into her window and spends the night with her. And then in the morning, every morning, he gets up, climbs out her window, goes down the ladder, across the alley, up the ladder into his room, and every night is that way. She grows tired of that, just to let you know how the opera goes. She grows tired of that and comes to the house with the kid. They sing a wonderful soprano and tenor duet, and towards the end of the duet, the father walks in on them. And they're there, and the kid is on the floor, and the father's not stupid, he puts it together. He berates the son. How could you do this to me? How could you consort with this woman? How could you, I mean, this is like the worst thing that you could ever do. It's quite a heroic aria in four parts with trombones and French horns and trumpets blaring and everything like that. And he swears vengeance. He says, you are going to be the object of thunderbolts when my vengeance comes down on you. And the soprano, in reaction to that, picks up the knife off the table and starts to kill her child. She pulls it back like this and has the baby like this. The father grabs the knife and says, what kind of mother are you that you could kill your child? And the soprano coolly looks at him and says, what kind of father are you that you can kill yours? And because suddenly this little light comedy has become a serious drama in like the last 5 minutes. So we're going to meet the tenor now who is married. And Alan, can we talk just a little bit about how you thought about this? Because you said you were doing this sort of like, the way I was wanting you to do it was sort of how you were doing art songs. Sure. So talk to us a little bit about that.
Well, we just pretty much learned it the way everyone else here learned the songs for today. Dissected each part and did sort of tricks for the mind to learn how to, like, one of the lines we used the game Tetris to learn.
For example, so. He could not remember the line, qual tetro aspetto prende la sorte mia. And I looked at Alan, he was going, qual, and I said, do you play that game where the things are falling down like this? He said, Tetris. I said, that's the word. He said, qual tetro aspetto? And now he knows the word. Okay? Yeah. So what is your torment that you're dealing with right now?
Well, basically, what you explained it beautifully. I'm married with a kid, but I have to keep it a secret. I'm living basically two lives. So it's just... I'm just tired of living two lives, two separate.
Exactly. And remember, he stands to lose a great deal. The father is very wealthy and going to give the money to the two kids. But of course, one of the things that he promises to withhold, should they be married, is his money. And so you stand to lose your life, literally. And so every day, he comes into this house, and in spite of the fact that he wants to be with his wife next door, he has to sit at breakfast with his father and say, hello, father. Yes, I'm fine, father. Oh, it was a delightful night, father. I slept very well. And be that way. And this is a torture. He says, if you read the words, he says the torture is to maintain a serene face in front of this. And to be in my condition and to keep a straight face and just say everything is okay. So let's hear the aria. This has a nice sized prelude which Jose is going to play. So here we go.
Thank you. letto prende la sorte mia.
Sul viso di pianto bagnato.
It's not an easy sing, huh?
No.
He wanted to know when we met about it if he could put it in E flat. You want to do the E flat now?
E flat?
You ask about ending with an E flat. No. You see what I mean? I said, I don't think when you learn this that you're going to want to sing an E flat. I think that's, but what you are doing is fabulous. It's great, great. Let's talk. Let me talk to Hojay for 1 second about what we're doing. So now, Hojay, can you get up for 1 second? Would you? We're going to have you come in over here, okay? Now, I want you to come in so that you are like this. You're going, and then I want you to tiptoe to the piano. You know what tiptoes are? Here we go, Grant. So here we go. So look and see if coast is clear. Look and see. Wait a minute. No, look and see first. Is the coast clear? You got to see. Is anybody there? Go back there. Go back there. Go back there. I want you to get this feeling. Look around here. Look here. Look at. See. Now tiptoe. Tiptoe, tiptoe, on your toes. On your toes. Now, okay. Now play, now play. Boom, 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 boom. Right there, right there. Shh. With the octave, with the octave, with the octave. Tiptoe, tiptoe, tiptoe. Tiptoe. Da, da, da. See, that's tiptoe piano playing. Very good. Sometimes you have to just act it out. Just, you gotta feel what it feels like. Are you ever on tiptoes, Hojay? Have you, let's say, when you are in Korea, for example, right? When you are at home, right? Did you ever come in late at home? And were you really careful because the parents are right there? I mean, like, for example, no, never mind, I'm not going to do that. That's what you have to play, is exactly that kind of sound, right? And then, what is this sound right here? Is this any way to live? See, the prelude of this piece is an amazing picture. I mean, you think it's just some stupid little pizzicato passage, but it tells the story of your life. That you are, in the dark, you run into things, you knock over a table, for example, a chair falls down or something like that, you are terrorized. And every day, this boy is doing this. And now he says, what is going to happen to me? I have my first hormones right here, and I'm living in a prison. Here we go. From the top of the page, touch. Something, put something away in the chest of drawers or something like that. And now you're going to talk about your father from the first tone talk about your father.
D'un crudo genitor la tirannia m'opprime m'incatena.
Now listen, you cannot have the sound of the word tirannia on the word tirannia. You gotta sing, D'un crudo genitor la tirannia m'opprime m'incatena. Well, that's what you gotta do.
D'un crudo genitor la tirannia m'opprime m'incatena. E sola è la mia pena.
Now, just speaking vocally, you have to get up and over that F natural.
Okay.
You are going straight at it like that. Ne so, like that. Ne so,
ne so, è la mia pena. Altri come divide il mio dolore.
I gotta talk.
Allarme forza.
Different.
Ma mi manca.
No, it's not different enough. It's not different enough, Alan. Parlarme forza. No, mi manca.
Parlarme forza.
Different.
Mi manca.
Different again.
Mi manca il cuore.
That's it. She was the first girl I was in love with, and I'm married to her, and I have a kid now, and look at what I'm doing with the first flower of my years. What does this mean, what you're going to sing right now?
It's emotion.
Well, would it help you if you had a picture? You know what she looks like?
My wife?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have a picture?
I think I do, yeah.
How about if you looked at her and sang, if you sing, do vro, and you look at her, you see her face, and you go, oh. Just look at her and sing those notes. Let's do, Penar Languir. That was it.
Penar Languir Dovro.
See her. Sing the veil on the top more closed.
I'm sorry?
Can you sing the veil on the top more closed?
Yes.
I know it's meant to be open. Sing it close, see what happens. Sing it a little bit more closed.
Oh.
to cook. Sentence. Here we go. And.
Strano cimento.
Che strano. Strano cimento. Che strano cimento. Che strazio. Che pena. Like that. Here we go.
Che strano cimento. Che strazio. Che pena. Mostrar nel tormento. Mentire piacere.
Sull'occhio, sul viso. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Sull'occhio, sul viso, il viato bagnato, stringe il riso, mentire di piacere. O barbaro stato, o crudo dovere. Sull'occhio, sul viso, di pianto bagnato, stringe il riso, mentire di piacere.
Okay, hold on a second. I want to go over to the end of the piece, because we got to stop. Yeah, can we go over to... Mentire il piacere, for right there, yeah. He's going to give you from, oh, barbaro stato, okay. Yep.
Oh, yeah.
First time? Mm-hmm.
Okay.
First time, yeah.
Yep. Oh, barbaro stato, o crudo dover. Oh, barbaro stato, o crudo dover. Oh, barbaro stato, o crudo.
Stay. No. Can you stay longer?
I think so.
Wait a minute. There's one of your tenor brethren is out here in the hall, Mr. Villa. Do you know Eduardo Villa?
He looks very familiar.
Well, he should. He's some caliph at the Metropolitan and things like that, right?
Okay, so
what did they write your name on the check for, Eduardo? What did they write your name on the check for? You know the check for your fee?
Yes.
Is that written for the high notes?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. I mean, all the stuff is nice. I hate to sound crass and commercial about it. Go talk to him. Go talk to him and ask him. Okay? So if you got a good one, stay on it. Okay?
Oh, barbaro stato, oh, crudo dover.
Thank you very much. Notice our future events. Marilyn has one more class to give in the last week of the summer, and we also have the song competition coming. So make your plan to be here. This is going to be a hot song contest, I can tell you that. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.